Good evening, everybody. Sorry we're starting a little bit late, but thank you for your patience. My name is Neil Pandia. I would like to welcome you all to the second Cyberspectrum Meetup, which serves as a forum for the exchange of knowledge and ideas related to software-defined radio, and generally aims to get people excited about all the applications that can be realized with the technology. Engineers, students, hobbyists, enthusiasts, people of all experience levels are welcome, no matter what your software or hardware background. At each meetup, people from the community will have the opportunity to present their work, projects, and ideas to the group. The event tonight is being sponsored by Edis Research and is hosted by NoiseBridge, a nonprofit hackerspace for technical creative projects. Tonight, we have a great lineup planned. First, Julian Arnold will give a short presentation about how to modify the driver for the Analog Devices 9361 transceiver chip, how to suit your needs and to enable hidden features. The 9361 is the transceiver used on the USRP B200, B210, and E310. Next, Nick Foster will give a talk about satellite communications and satellite tracking using GNU Radio, SDR hardware, and homebrew antennas. Then Josh Meyer will give a talk about a project to capture and analyze many gigabytes of RF telemetry data taken from a rocket launch at Vandenberg Air Force Base. And last but not least, Jonathan Pendulum will give a presentation as well as a live demonstration of RF network on a chip, commonly called RF NOC, which is a new framework that aims to make FPGA acceleration for SDR more easily accessible. All meetup presentations will be recorded and posted online, as well as streamed live on YouTube. If you are off-site but would like to contact the physical group here, please hop on IRC at the channel shown on the screen. Is the channel shown on the screen, Bong?
It will be. Actually, it is, yeah. Just put a hash in front of that and you're good.
Last month's event has already been posted in full HD video and has appeared on Hackaday. Future meetup locations will alternate every month between South Bay and here in San Francisco. The next meetup will be held in mid-January at the Edis Research Office in Santa Clara. Please check the meetup website for the final date and for further details as the date gets closer. If you have any ideas about topics for future talks and presentations, please let us know. We would like to thank all of our speakers tonight for their efforts and enthusiasm, and we would especially like to thank NoiseBridge for providing this space and hosting the meetup.
Yeah!
We would ask that you leave a small donation in the donation bucket by the entrance to support them. Free beer and pizza are available, courtesy of Edis Research, on the tables over there. There's still some left, so please help yourself. At this point, we'll finally get started, and I'll ask Ball and Siebert to add a few comments and introduce our first speaker.
Thank you, Neil.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you very much for coming out, braving the rain, and joining us here at NoiseBridge for the second Cyberspectrum SDR meetup. If you've got a laptop in front of you and have IRC, or if you're watching online with the live stream, which is hopefully still streaming and being ingested by YouTube, hop on Freenode. The channel is pound or hash, depending on where you're from, Cyberspectrum. And there are quite a few people on there already, I think. And let's have a look at the encoder stats. We've got 15 people watching so far on the live stream, so hopefully that's working. If you're out there in internet land, please comment in the IRC channel as to how that's looking. For all you newcomers, especially the tall one standing in the corner there, feel free to find a chair. There should be some chairs further down the back there, even right around the back. Get comfy. I'll help out with that in a minute once we get started. In fact, if you want to be a front row bandit, there are a couple of free spots right down the front here. So again, big thanks to Edis Research for sponsoring tonight, and to NoiseBridge, this incredible hackerspace that was recently revamped and looks mighty fine now. So we've got some great talks lined up tonight, but I'd like to encourage you. You made it, cool. We've got some more people joining us here. Please spread the word if you can, whatever your choice of social media, Twitter or IRC, or if you've got a blog or what have you, spread the word. We'd like to get some more SDR excitement happening in the Bay Area, so please do that if you can. And also, feel free absolutely to submit a talk or an idea or even a request for some sort of topic to be covered at future meetups. We'd like to do this as a monthly thing, and you know, feel free to submit on anything you like, whether it's, you know, some sort of beginner content, something more advanced. We're open to any sort of ideas and presentations, so please do so. Finally, at the end of this, I'll try and aggregate everything together from the speakers. If they do decide to share any links, then I'll generally put them on this post-meetup page. So if you hit the Cyber Spectrum meetup website and you go to pages, you'll see the meetup links there. So you can visit that after the fact to get whatever goodies are left by the speakers. Now, one quick poll I thought we'd do. Obviously, it's Wednesday today. How does Wednesday suit everybody? Would there be another day that would be better for people? I mean, obviously, you're all here, so there's going to be a bit of selection bias, but maybe a Thursday might be better. Can I have like a show of hands for Wednesday? Keep it on a Wednesday? Yeah, pretty good. What about Thursday? Tuesday? Looks like the Wednesday's happened then.
Okay.
Sold. So next month, we're going to head back down to the South Bay. Check out the URL there in the coming weeks to see what we'll have on offer then and where we will host it. We'll probably be in the same place as last time. And you know, I generally like to tweet about these sorts of things, so feel free to check out any tweets there. Now, as I said, we've got this OpenBTS running on the embedded device here. This is actually the dial plan. So how many of you are actually able to successfully register your own phone number? Yep. All right, cool. So I've actually got my mobile here. So does somebody want to try and give me a call there? I do believe last time I checked that was my phone number down the bottom. So if you call me.
You log in and it sends you from 101, it sends you.
It sends you a text, yes. And then you reply to that text with a 4-digit phone number that you want to have on the network as your own number. So if somebody wants to text me or phone me, then feel free to do so at any time. As a test, I suppose I will dial 600, which is the echo test, and hopefully we'll hear the lady on the other end.
Echo test. In this mode, everything
you say will be repeated back. You hear that? So that's actually asterisk, which is a soft switch running on the embedded device. And the idea of this test is that my voice will head back to the soft switch and then be sent back so that you can test the latency and ensure that the system's working. And so it is. Does anybody want to give me a phone call? Don't be shy. You can call me anytime on OpenBTS. Oh, I got a text from 8008 Woot. Who was that? Hey, all right, we got a text. Nobody wants to call? All right, fine. Call me later then. So you can dial any one of those other numbers. So that's going to be running for the duration of the thing if you want to play around. So actually this is out of order, but that's all good. Nick Foster.
Oh, come on.
It's going to be talking about some cool satellite hacking. Yeah, actually you're going to be second, right? But Nick is generally better known as the Next Gen Hacker. I had the pleasure of working with him for a time at EDIS, and I have him, in fact, to thank for a large part for sending me the half-working USOAP one that kind of got me hooked. So thanks, Nick. We're also going to have Josh, who's over there in the corner. They went on an expedition. In fact, a couple of your friends are here as well. Went on an expedition down to Vandenberg, and watched a nice rocket launch and captured some telemetry. Go the reverse engineering there. And we've got SDR John just over here. Jonathan, I don't know who that other weirdo is in the background next to him, but yeah, there should be some good FPGA hackery coming out of that. FPGAs often underlie a lot of what SDR does, so hopefully this will give you an idea of how that can be made more accessible. And Neil, of course, an instrumental part of the show here. Unfortunately, a little bit of a cold tonight, but hopefully, you know, good wishes and get well soon. And then first up, we have Julian Arnold. I think last time the applause was indicative that you would in fact be awarded Intern of the Month again, potentially. I think maybe we'll use this occurrence here as the final decision maker. So at the end of his show and tell here, your applause will be used to judge whether or not he's awarded Intern of the Month again. We have him from Germany at the moment.
It's 3 months? 4 months, right?
He's holding the same beard.
Is he holding the same beer? why don't you strike that exact pose now, just next to the projector? No? Okay. All right. Do you want to take it away? All right. Go, Julian. We're just going to swap projectors here.
This can take a while, so you can keep on copying.
Well, Julian sets up.
Oh man, this is.
If it's all right, I might ask you to participate in a little bit of a poll here. Could I get a show of hands? How many people have used GNU Radio? That's pretty good. How many of you use it on a regular basis, not just sort of hackery, but yeah, and. How many of you use an RTL dongle? All right. Pardon? couldn't quite hear that, Nick.
You're missing an important part there.
What's the important part?
How many people would like to use a dongle?
How many people would like to use a dongle? Okay. That can be easily rectified. Take it away, Julian.
Yeah, so, welcome everybody. So my name is Julian, and some of you might know me from last month's meetup. And I'm interning with Edis Research, and as last month, I was again not forced to give this quick show and tell. So that being said, let me show and tell you how I revealed some hidden features of my beloved SDR. So of course, I'm interning with Edis, so it's an Edis device, it's an Edis B210. And so the Edis B210 has, like Neil already said, the AD9361 transceiver on it, which is a very powerful device. It is highly integrated. It works from 70 megahertz up to 6 gigahertz. It supports various of channel bandwidth and has a very rich feature set. But it turns out, while I was doing my interning stuff, not only drinking coffee and YouTubing very hard, not all of the features are yet exposed. And so I thought, well, maybe I should do some real work for my money and not only drinking coffee. So I tried to expose some more of the features of the of this nice device, which is this one. I don't know how many of you know this device, the B210, the B200 series. Some people, okay, not too bad. I started taking a closer look at it. I started taking a closer look at this RF front-end chip, and then I found some interesting features that were not yet exposed. And when you try to do stuff like that, you have basically two resources. So there's the register map of the chip, which lists all registers, gives a little information about the registers, and which is basically enough to get an overview of what you probably can do. And then ADI provides user guides for all the features that give more detail. So I started digging in the register map, and in the register map I found this AGC mode. So the device apparently supports AGC, which I thought, oh, that's handy, because manually adjusting the gain, as some of you might know, can sometimes be a pain in the, So I was like, okay, why not try to expose this feature? And then I was like, okay, so I guess ADI wants me to use their user guide to expose this feature and to know how this feature works. So I started to take a look at the user guide. And what you will find there is something like this flow graph, and you'll be like, oh, okay, that's a lot of information. That must be easier. So I just stick to the register map, and what you will find there is something like this. So you will find the page that lists, or you will find all registers there and the description of the bits in the register. So, I mean, if you're not familiar with this, this is how most of these devices work. So you have registers and you have bits in the registers, and these bits somehow dictate how the device operates. And so the device will be hooked up on some kind of bus, like SPI, I2C, and then you can write these registers. So I found this 0FA register, which is AGC config 1, and this has this on the bits D0 and D1, RX1 gain control setup. And so if you scroll a little bit down, you will find this table which says, okay, if you write particular values to this bit, this will enable, well, either the fast attack or the slow attack or a hybrid AGC mode. And I was like, okay, that's better than this flow graph and stuff in the user guide, so I will just give it a try. That's what I did. So this is what I ended up with. So if you want to give it a try and modify your driver code, you just browse to the driver, which has this path there in UHD, which is open source, so it's pretty handy. You just go there. And with your knowledge from the register map, you can just read the register from the bus and write whatever value back. So this is what I did here. So in the first line, I read the register back because I don't want to modify the whole register. I just want to modify these two bits dictating the AGC mode. So I read the register back, and then depending on the game mode, so here, I just shift in whatever value I want to have depending on the game mode in these two bits we've seen earlier, bit D0 and D1. And then in the last line, I just write it back. So that's all I did. Good question, yeah.
How does that affect your power consumption?
It depends on what the gain mode sets, right? So the AGC sets. I mean, if you manually set the gain, you can end up with having the same power consumption. I think so. So I haven't done measurements. But, okay. So that's what I did, and apparently it worked. So it's pretty easy, pretty straightforward. So I give you a short example of that later. But first, let me tell you there's more. So you can, as I did the AGC support, then this chip has RSSI and temperature sensors, which you can read out and expose. It has analog filters that you can modify. Yeah, analog filters modified by software, this is pretty cool. And you have digital filters that you can modify at runtime, also pretty cool. And yeah, let me quickly show what how this looks like, and then I'm done with my quick show and tell.
Can you hold this? I'm running out of space.
We're just plugging in the unit here. And apparently I'm the designated holder of the device.
The antenna. You are the antenna.
I am the antenna.
So this is the flow graph I'm using. It's pretty simple. It's just an FM receiver. So I'm getting the signal in. I'm low-pass filtering it. Then I use the quadrature demode, which is giving me the instantaneous frequency, and then I'm resampling it for my audio device and just playing it. But, so this is just regular GRC, so I needed to modify the Python code and write some glue code to get my features working. So I'm not running it from GRC companion, I'm just running it out of the console. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, okay,
never mind. Oh. Where's your console?
Oh, yeah.
Ah.
Yes, that it is. So it will load the flow graph. First it will load the FPGA image. And then you will hear this receiver, but with the ability to enable the AGC mode. So apparently for FM is maybe not the best example because FM was designed to not be affected by gain changes that much, but okay. So we have FM reception here. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to set the gain manually for now.
Oh, brilliant.
The USB cable's in bad condition.
Stop holding it.
Unplug.
I said you're the antenna, okay?
My apologies.
Don't move.
I shall not move. By the way, as you've heard, Julian has excellent choice in music for these demos. What were you listening to then, Julian?
It's radio, I don't know.
Can't we decode RDS on that?
Not yet. So, I'm going to set the gain manually first. Very low.
Do you want me to hold the laptop so you can talk on the laptop?
And apparently the signal is too strong, so even on the lowest gain it's still receiving. That was different in our office. So the gain is, the signal is too strong, so even now, so in our office it was different. Yeah, okay.
That'll do it.
So we're even able to decode the signal with zero gain, so, but let me switch on the AGC anyways. So now it's operating AGC mode. You see that the power was raised up. Now it's supposed to be the optimal gain, but you can't hear the difference on the FM. But okay, it's working, so my code worked. This small piece of code, it's as easy as that. You can do it on your own. Pretty straightforward. Maybe one other example.
Put your hand on the top of the antenna.
Because we can So what I did here, so I also exposed the ability to write analog filters. And what I did here, I just removed the low-pass filter from the flow graph. So you're getting a lot of, so multiple channels at a time. That sounds terrible, right? And but what we can do now with a slider, with a very slider on the very bottom, we can adjust the analog filter in the front end to be 100 kilohertz.
Hint, hint.
Yeah, further, 100,000. Yeah. And normally now we should hear the signal very clearly, but I don't know what the user pulled it wrong this time.
Looks good, anybody?
Ah, okay, so now it sounds better, because what we did, we changed the analog filter in the front end via software in real time, and it was as easy as the AGC hack. So it's pretty cool, you can do it on your own, give it a try. That's it, thank you.
Was that the applause for, to measure the success of the intern of the month, or should we do a proper? I think that was a pretty hearty applause there. I think shall we do the award then? I think so.
Yeah.
All right.
Why not?
Julian is a great intern and. The first month, he actually made his own award, so he was the self-proclaimed intern of the month. And he's been bugging me about it ever since, practically every day, right? Probably? So I thought we'd finally make it official.
Okay.
So I'd like to present Julian with the Edis Research Intern of the Month Award. It reads, for doing most excellent work with Edis Hardware and UHD and generally being a good sport. Because we give him a bit of a hard time. It's a pleasure having you on the team. And it's, so you can see, or not, signed by me, the trustworthy dude, remember?
Yeah.
Remember
yeah,
that
sure.
Time? And by Matt.
So, oh!
Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thanks, Julian. So now let's proceed to the next speaker. Nick, do you want to take the floor? Absolutely. What have you got in store for us, Nick? I'll do a quick intro to tell you a little bit about our next speaker. Oh, actually, I wanted to do an intro for Julian, and on IRC, I posed the question to the channel, how would people describe Julian? What sort of adjectives would you use? Just to give the audience out there an idea of what kind of a guy he is. Neil was nice enough to say Julian is a really cool German guy who loves hacking on SDR. And then there were some other adjectives that popped up, and I just sort of glanced into the channel, and I saw things like beautiful, intelligent, handsome, and strong. And then I looked at who had actually written these in the channel, and of course it was Julian himself. So
it's the truth.
Yeah, it's the truth.
Neil also said he's a German guy with a funny accent. He's passionate about good coffee and cannot drive a manual transmission without burning the clutch. And Julian also, as it turns out, loves SpongeBob quarter pants. So anyway, that's Julian. Nick is going to talk about satellite communications. Born in the methane swamps of Grothak, the sentient clown of Aminaz? No, Nick Foster quickly absorbed the remnants of his spawn folk and grew to immense power and size before moving on to consume even larger planetary systems. His interests include galactic domination, Nicolas Cage movies, and long romantic walks off of short piers. Does that about sum you up, Nick?
That works.
Nick is currently, I think that's going to be the subject of his talk, doing some really interesting SDR work for a startup company called Spire. Prior to that, he was the hardware engineer at Edis Research and designed some cool products, one of which is running now. So you want the projector cable?
Yeah. Okay. All right, so I'm Nick Foster, and this is How to Track Satellites and Frighten Your Neighbors. About myself, besides what Ballant mentioned, which was, I don't know if you can't hear me, just yell, because I'm very bad with microphones. I can yell if you want. About myself, besides what Ballant said, which was, I thought he wasn't actually going to read aloud, I'm ex-Edis Research. I used to work with Ballant and these fine gentlemen over here. I'm an SDR enthusiast, which means I'm just a giant dork about radio stuff. I'm a GNU Radio developer whenever people actually take my code contributions, which is not too often because it sucks. I wrote GR AirModes, GR AIS, and GR SmartNet, which may be familiar to a couple of people in the room if you've used GNU Radio before. I'm currently doing comms consulting for Spire, which is a satellite CubeSat company just down the street here at Folsom and 11th. Are there any Planet Labs people in the house right now? I knew it. I'll talk to you guys after. Planet Labs is possibly our competitor, sort of, so I won't say anything important, don't worry. I'm just living up 17th Street in the city. I've been here for about 7 years. I'm clearly really bad at PowerPoint, so please don't criticize. And I'm also cheap as dirt, which is the subject of this talk. So why do you care about listening to satellites? What's up there to listen to? It used to be a pretty barren place. It used to be strictly commercial stuff. There wasn't a whole lot of interesting stuff up there. These days, there's a whole lot of interesting stuff to hear. There's weather satellites, which people have been receiving since the 60s. There are all sorts of interesting science payloads in orbit. There are multiple GNSS, GPS-like constellations for positioning. China's got their system up, Russia's got a system up, the Europeans have a system up, and there's GPS. There's the usual media satellites. You can receive all sorts of interesting backhaul transmissions. There's all sorts of really interesting video stuff that you're not supposed to see that is broadcast in the clear on open protocols on a lot of different satellites. So point to an Intelsat transponder, use a DVB-S2 receiver, and all of a sudden some really interesting stuff, off-air stuff. Anybody seen that Bill O'Reilly clip where he says, F it, I'll do it live? It's that kind of stuff. It's all the stuff that's not supposed to, because they're continuously broadcasting this stuff, but we'll get to that later. There are military payloads, and while you're never going to be able to actually hear or actually decode the military payloads, just knowing where the satellites are is incredibly valuable information. There's a Canadian dude who is tracking through RF and through visual means, through a telescope in his backyard, tracking the position of military satellites as they move in orbit. And it's gotten so bad that the U.S. government is actually actively hiding its satellites from him by pointing the solar panels of the satellite away from his house so the sun never reflects the image back at him. So clearly they're concerned about the Canadians. Obviously, this is the ISS. You can use a ham radio and talk to astronauts on the ISS at any time it passes over your head. And then there's a whole bunch of amateur satellites, ham sats. There's university experiment sats, and most of those are on CubeSats. And CubeSats are hugely interesting, and that's what we're going to focus on for the most part, because they're easy to listen to. And the big answer to why I listen to satellites is because space is awesome. It's so much fun. This is a launch a couple of people in this room will recognize, because it was the best photograph of CubeSats in space on the internet right now. These are a pair of Planet Labs satellites. Anybody, can you tell me which specific flock this was?
That was 1A.
This was 1A? Okay, so this is a pair of Earth imaging satellites with proprietary camera payloads. These are 3U CubeSats. And if I say anything that's wrong about them, please correct me. What's that?
Yeah.
So these were launched off the ISS. You can see what's called a nanorax launcher at the top right side of the thing, and it just sort of spits them out spring-loaded into space. Nanorax recently had, incidentally, a really bad malfunction where it spit a bunch of these guys' satellites into space uncommanded. Do you know where those are right now?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Oh, that's good. So about Spire, I'm consulting for Spire right now. I'm not full-time, so I don't really represent the company, but I'm still happy to talk about them. It used to be called NanoSatisfy, which was the worst name a company ever gave itself. Formerly, before that, it was Artusat, and it all started from a Kickstarter where the guys wanted to launch a CubeSat into space as an experiment that had an Arduino payload on it that kids could, you know, schools could use to run their own experiments on. It sort of worked. There aren't really any experiments running on the Arduino on the thing, but what it did more for them was allow them to collect funding to actually start a company based around launching CubeSats into space to do all sorts of interesting Earth imaging and radio payload stuff. Why are we using CubeSats? There's a number of reasons. The most compelling reason is because NASA mandated that anything going into space that they pay for also has to carry CubeSats. It also has to have the ability to carry CubeSats. The reasoning behind that was we used to launch a lot of lead into space for ballast because rocket payloads need to be very predictable in performance. And if your satellite, if your main payload, if your giant $100 million communication satellite doesn't weigh exactly as much as the rocket is capable of carrying, you add lead to make up the difference. It doesn't do anybody a lot of good to launch a lot of lead into space, so they decided later on, maybe we can fill that space with other satellites instead. And the side benefit of doing that is that launching those satellites is extremely cheap. Later on, Nanorax sort of got into the business of flying stuff up to the ISS and launching off of there, but that's sort of a different business model. CubeSats tend to be cheap to build. They're not intended to last very long, so you don't have to worry about making them rad hard. You don't worry about all that space-qualified hardware stuff. You know, you test one, and if it works for a couple of years, you're happy. Sensors are getting very low power, CPUs are getting very low power, and that means we can take advantage of Moore's Law. It has the side benefit, again, of solar panels. You don't need as much solar area if your sensors and your CPU take up much less power, so everything gets smaller. And you can afford to be aggressive. You can afford to be kind of crazy with your designs. You can launch stuff into space and hope it works. You know, you test as best you can on the ground, and if it doesn't work, well, you're going to launch another couple dozen anyway, so who cares? And lastly, yes, we are hiring very aggressively, so if anybody here would like to work on space things, because it's awesome, you should come talk to me. So if you have a satellite, if you launch a satellite in space, you need a ground station to talk to it, and ground stations are really, really expensive. This is the Intelsat Napa Valley Teleport ground station. I spend a lot of time here for another client. These guys really know what they're doing, and it's hilarious to see their control room because they have 400 TV screens with all of their different channels that they're relaying, broadcast simultaneously. It's very cool. It looks like a movie. But it costs more than I can afford out of pocket. So what do you do? What do you need? You need an antenna, okay, to talk to a satellite. You need an antenna. You need a LNA, a low noise amplifier. You need a filter to filter out stuff you don't want to hear. You need an antenna rotator to point to where the satellite is, especially if you have low Earth, if you're trying to track a low Earth orbit satellite, they move very quickly across the sky. And lastly, you need a radio. Strangely, the rotator is actually the most expensive part in the price class that we're dealing with because it's a mechanical part and mechanical things are expensive. Meet the Moonraker. Moonraker is the freak out your neighbors part. I had this mounted on my roof for a while and I actually had people knocking on my door asking if I was working for the NSA. It was built 80% out of parts that I found in the garage because my former landlord was a hoarder. The only parts I think I had to buy were those nylon threads, at least for the antenna. The rotator's different, but at least for the antenna, all I had to buy was those nylon threaded rod and the antenna connector. The rest is all garbage. Yeah?
Do you always use circular polarization? That's what that is.
Yeah, so we'll talk about that in a minute. Actually, we'll talk about that next. Antenna, this is a helical antenna. It's one of the most forgiving antenna designs you can build for getting a reasonable amount of gain to a satellite, and it is what's called circular polarized, which means that if you're talking to a linearly polarized satellite, you're going to lose 3 dB, you're going to lose half your signal, but that's actually totally okay. We don't care about performance for this. The only thing you lose is if you're dealing with left-hand circular polarization, because this is a right-hand polarized antenna, and honestly, nobody's doing that. Everybody's linear up on the CubeSat now anyway. So it actually makes for the satellite guys here, because most of the satellites tend to have linear downlinks, we use circular polarization so we don't get faded. So it's very easy, the close-up, it's very easy to build one of these. You can ask me, I can send you plans. The close-up of the really janky-looking solder job on the bottom there is a matching network, which is the only tricky part to build about this thing, and it's actually stupid easy to make. And that's just necessary to match the antenna to 50 ohms so that you can plug it into any old radio. Next, the low noise amplifier. This is a cheap little kit part. Yes, the image says copyrighted because I shamelessly stole it off their website, but it's free publicity, so whatever. Satellites are very low power because power is expensive in space. Satellites are very far away. And so you need, because radios are noisy, you need an amplifier to bring that signal up to where you can hear it to bring it out of the noise. Typically, you want to put this amplifier, as close to the antenna as possible because every inch of coax in between your amplifier and your antenna is more loss. So you stick the amplifier right on the antenna, and then after that, it doesn't matter how much cable you run. The only figure of merit you care about is noise figure or noise temperature. There are other ones, but the primary one is noise figure, and that tells you how much additional noise the amplifier injects into your signal. This particular one is, I think it's 0.6 dB. LNA kits are cheap because the ham guys use them, and because parts are getting more expensive, or less expensive, rather. So for 70 centimeters, where I built that helical antenna for, it's extremely cheap. If you want to work for TV satellites, if you want to get up to S-band, if you want to get up to C-band, KU-band, that's where all the DirecTV stuff is. That's where all the, you know, the EchoStar, you know, if anybody remembers EchoStar. And so just go ahead and take apart one of those low-noise block-down converters. Take apart basically the antenna feed for a DBS satellite, and there's your amplifier. It's free. You can get them on Craigslist. People are throwing them away. Go ahead.
Where does your power come from on that? I'm sorry, I'm a ham, so...
Oh, so you can do power a couple of ways. You can either feed it through the coax for some of the amplifier designs, or you just provide power on a separate line. And my particular...
I'm curious, because that looks like CMA.
Sorry?
Those plugs look like CMA.
Those are SMA on there. Yeah, and I think this one is... there's a bias T you can see in the upper corner there. So this one actually pulls power off the coax.
Sorry for slowing you down, I just...
Not at all. So filters, you need a filter, especially in San Francisco. Anybody who's ever done radio experimentation within city limits understands this. I used to have a 40-meter dipole on the roof, a big 20-meter-long antenna, and at night, on a dark night, you could stick an antenna across some terminals of that antenna and see it light. Okay, that's microwatts of power being received by the antenna on my roof. I live just over a mile away from Sutro Tower here, so 5 megawatts of RF gets into everything. You can't use a scope, you can't use a network analyzer, you can't use a spectrum analyzer. You have to take incredible precautions to get anything done. So it's possibly the worst environment. So you need a filter to get rid of K-fog before you can try to hear anything. And because we're receive-only, filters can be small and cheap. You get a SAW filter, you get a mini-circuits parts just off-the-shelf commercial filters to try to reject as much of that as you can. The rotator is the interesting part, and we'll bring the lights up if anybody can grab the lights. There's lots of options for antenna rotators out there, or at least there's a few of them. They're all designed for the ham world, and they all suck. They're expensive, they break, they're lame, they're not really suited to driving a satellite dish. They're just not good. And also, I'm really cheap, and so surplus hardware is always better, and nobody sells surplus antenna rotators because nobody makes them. This is the Pelco PT570PP. This is a security camera mount. Government installations everywhere use these things, okay? And so they show up on the surplus market, they show up on eBay all the time. This is the nice one. The PP means it has position feedback, so you can actually drive it to a certain point. And so it's extremely useful for antenna pointing. Used to be, there was a Canadian guy on eBay who found 5 of these for $20, which was hilarious. I got into the market just after he bought all of them, and I paid more like $150 for it. So they're still out there. They're not as cheap as they used to be, but you can still find them. But you can't really use it. Go ahead.
I was going to ask, what's the pointing accuracy with the built-in antennas?
Good enough to do VHF, not good enough for X-band. So you can get about a degree, maybe degree and a half. So if you want better accuracy than that, you're going to have to start doing some compensation for nonlinearity. But there's almost no slop in the mechanism, so you can do pretty well. But you're going to have to hack it to get it to work because it was designed as a camera rotator and not as an antenna rotator. The big thing about it is that there's no RS-232 or USB interface. You have to kind of roll your own. There's no go-to command. It's only set up to be able to save a preset and go back to that preset, which is useless if you want to be able to track a satellite across the sky. So you really have to hack it. I could have built my own controller, but I'm lazy. I'm also cheap and I didn't want to have to buy hardware. So we also need it to read the position feedback pots so that it can know where it is in real time and actually hone in on a position. But inside the same box I got off eBay, there's this thing, which is this, I don't even know what it was intended to do. It was intended to convert one proprietary stupid protocol to another proprietary stupid protocol. But it had a PIC on board, and a PIC's got A to D converters so I can read the position feedback pots. It also has a serial port, which gives me a serial command. I didn't get schematics, but I emailed the vendor, and the vendor was highly confused by what I was trying to do with it. He said, good luck, here's some schematics, have fun. And I wrote some PIC code for it, and the PIC code, all it does is take in Yaesu standard rotator command, so it acts just like a commercial off-the-shelf rotator, and it converts that to commands that this box understands. And it basically says, go, 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 stop. And continues doing that 10 times per second and tracks stuff across the sky. Everybody knows what this is, right? Raise your hands if you haven't seen this before. Anybody? Okay, this is called an RTL-SDR dongle. This is a satellite TV receiver that some genius figured out how to turn into a general-purpose software-defined radio receiver a couple years ago. You can get 2.5 megahertz of bandwidth for $20. So this is the best deal in radio today. Buy one if you don't have one now. Start hacking on it. It's awesome. This used to be $400 worth of hardware just a few years ago. So, and I used to work for the guys selling that hardware, so I can say that. There you go. So he gave a guy one just a few minutes ago, and he's already got it running now. So it's also user friendly. There's all sorts of really interesting stuff that you can do with this. Just search Google for RTL-SDR. one of which is receiving satellites. So what can you hear out there, and why do you care? We're interested in the lower frequency stuff. This is just sort of, this is a lot of text I'm not going to read, but this is just sort of a high-level overview of some of this stuff, just a small fraction of the stuff that's out there to listen to. We're going to deal with the lower frequency stuff because we're cheap, and lower bandwidth means we can actually receive it with a RTL dongle. We don't need a low noise block down converter, which is a transverter. It's just a thing that takes the incredibly high frequency that some of these higher bands operate at and down converts it to a lower frequency that ordinary radios can receive. And lastly, this thing is not terribly accurate. Less antenna gain means you don't have to point very accurately, and the higher bands demand more gain. So there are ISM band satellites out there. I don't know if anybody saw this. This was just comedy to me because the company I was working for was actually debating putting downlinks in the ISM band. And they called me to ask me about this, about the feasibility of doing this, and this was basically my reaction. But it turns out getting FCC allocations is like incredibly difficult, so, and takes a very long time. So software, we talked about hardware. Software stack is very easy. It's all open source software. You can hear all sorts of interesting stuff without ever having to write a line of code. We're using off-the-shelf ham radio rote control D to point the thing. We're using G-Predict to track the satellites and provide position updates. We're using GQRX, which is sort of a GNU radio-based spectrum visualization and spectrum saving tool. GNU radio to do anything that's not done off the shelf. You'll end up, if you want to actually receive anything, you'll end up having to probably write your own protocol-specific software receiver, but hopefully you can get all the way down to the protocol level before you have to think about it. And then baudline for software or for spectrum visualization. The nice part about CubeSats is that they're most of them are using ancient protocols, just stuff that's been around for years, because it's proven, it's flown in space before, the space community tends to be very conservative. So you'll see stuff like HDLC and AX25, both of which are 40-year-old protocols, flying around in space right now. And it's not the best way to do things, but it's really easy to receive. You'll see CW, Morse code. I don't know if anybody in here is... Can read Morse code off a screen, but you'll have the opportunity. The bottom two lines of this I could go on for hours about, but it turns out universities are really bad at security. There are a whole lot of wide open satellites floating around in space right now that anybody who's really interested in doing terrible things could take advantage of. It's not the most responsible thing to point that out, but I find it really hilarious that nobody thought about this before.
You need to have a transmitter at that point.
Yeah, you need to. Yeah, okay. I'm not talking about transmitters, so I'm safe. This points to a wider thing, which is that radio engineers are not security engineers, and college students don't tend to be security engineers. And every time the field of radio advances, the hacking opportunities advance with it, because the radio engineers design a system where they say nobody's ever going to have the hardware to hack this. And then 20 years later, people have the hardware to hack this, and all of a sudden things start getting gross. So CubeSats, this is an example. This is the Seeds 2 CubeSat, and the Morse code savvy among you will be able to read that off the Morse code beacon that it's transmitting. The nice part about CW is it makes, and the reason I'm using it here is because it makes a really nice, because its bandwidth is so narrow, it makes a really nice spectrogram. So it shows up very well on the screen. More complex or smarter protocols tend to just look like noise. This is some other university CubeSat, I don't remember which one. What you're seeing here is numbers being used for Morse code telemetry. This is a NOAA APT weather service picture. This is basically weather facts. This is also an ancient protocol, it's very easy to decode. It's very narrow band, it operates at 137 megahertz. You can build what's called a turnstile antenna, you can just look it up. You can receive this with an RTL dongle tomorrow if you're interested, with basically no extra hardware. There's already open source software out there that'll enable you to receive this. It's basically the easiest way to get started into receiving cool pictures from space. If you get hardcore about it, this is LRPT, low rate picture transmission, I believe. This is a very sophisticated protocol from the NOAA. This is not my picture because I don't have a setup that'll receive it right now. But this is what all the cool kids are doing because you can get really high resolution 2048 by 2048 pictures of the Earth in full color from space. The last hint about that, you can't receive it in an RTL dongle because you can't get 3 megahertz of bandwidth continuously out of it. Go ahead.
The NOAA satellites tend to be geosynchronous.
Some of them, so the GOES satellites are geosynchronous satellites. The NOAA satellites, actually I can show you here. Share the screen here. The NOAA satellites, NOAA 19, 18, 15, 16, the other ones that are up, those are actually in medium Earth orbit.
The reason I'm asking is, for example, here on the West Coast, it would be difficult to get a geosynchronous satellite over the East Coast. It's possible, but it would be difficult.
The GOES satellites, anybody here who might know, because I don't know offhand, I don't believe they're LRPT. They don't actually broadcast LRPT. It's the NOAA satellites that do. And those are lower in orbit. So other things that I've received that I wasn't expecting to receive. This is an Argus beacon. This is they use this for like wildlife tracking and for I don't know why I received it in the middle of San Francisco. I still can't tell you. But it was jumping all over a transmission I was trying to receive, and it took me days to figure out that it was in fact a wildlife tracking beacon.
Tracking ankle.
Yeah, an ankle bracelet on somebody. That seems in the city. That seems more likely. I like that. I don't know if they're satellite enabled though.
That's wildlife, right?
It's wild. Right now, what I'm working on is a high speed transceiver for a high speed downlink. I'm not going to talk about it in any sort of detail, but I mean, the radio savvy among you can pick up a few things from it. We recently just tested that transceiver from a balloon because we weren't able to get a launch in time and sent it up to the edge of space on a balloon to space qualify the hardware. And this is a picture just after the balloon popped. I won't show a picture of what the hardware looked like after it landed because it was kind of a hard landing. And that's pretty much what I have here. I have a demo up here. I didn't realize how hard it was going to be to see from back there, but I can drive the antenna pointer around if you are interested to see how it works, or I can just leave it set up and we can talk later about it.
Drive it?
All right. I have hardware, I might as well drive it.
You don't have the stick on it.
Have you had one of those outside for like several months?
It's been in my roof for a while. I took it off. Birds crapped on it. It got rained on a couple of times. We didn't have a whole lot of rain this last summer, so it hasn't been out through a whole lot of it, but It's all weather sealed, and the company that sells them leaves them out in the rain for years at a time. So I'm more worried about wind load. I haven't really set it through a windstorm with a dish on it yet, but it seems pretty solidly built. It's all worm gears and chain drive on the inside, so it seems pretty solid.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I guess I was going to ask the same question about whether it was meant for outdoor use. I gave a quick Google because I was remembering a rotor that was really common in the world of AMSAT years ago, and I last set up an AMSAT station. It's the Alliance 100. Do you know that rotor?
It's
a relatively cheap rotor, and I think the reason it became common to the AMSAT users is that the shaft would go all the way through. It was normally
mount a clamp to it.
Yeah, you put two Yagis on it and it's bound.
Yeah. A lot of the stuff I saw was intended for picking up like 1 pound or something like that, or was intended for something light enough to sit on a tripod. And this thing was the only thing I found that was beefy enough and cheap enough. So.
The U100 is like a real antenna. Like back in the day when one would actually purchase a TV antenna for the roof.
So it
may not be common now. I guess what I'm asking is if you know if they're common now. And
I haven't seen one. I haven't. I don't know if that rotor is even computer controllable. I suspect it's probably one of the ones that has the little knob that you just turn.
Right,
so you'd have to build an interface to drive it off of anything else.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Say that again. It's funny you mention that. We put this particular piece, let me go back to it here. This particular balloon launch was with a USRP E300 on board, sort of a pre-production model that Edis Research was nice enough to loan me on extended loan. They're not going to get that back. But the case, which I don't know if anybody saw, that there's a video of Bont running over an E300 in its incredibly strong aluminum case with his car, and the case was just about the only thing that survived the landing of the balloon.
Thanks, Ben. It's a good data point.
I won't send you a picture of what it looked like after it landed either.
Please do.
What's that? I thought I was going to run it, but it seems like it's misbehaving. Hold on a sec.
Well, I'm just curious.
What took that picture?
That's balloon pieces.
But there's the item. What
took the picture in this picture?
Yes.
A camera. I'm not really at liberty to talk about the camera, unfortunately.
But from where? That was the device controlled by the balloon.
I'm sorry?
Where was the camera that took that picture?
Underneath the balloon. So the balloon, you're seeing the fragments of the balloon sort of bursting, and then this is probably a second after the burst when the satellite is now tumbling.
That's not the satellite.
You can't see the satellite in this image. You can only see balloon and Earth.
Did you send the picture down through the radio?
Unfortunately, I did not send the picture down through the radio. The radio was operating and they wouldn't let me. I had it all set up to do FFmpeg and sort of pipe it through Netcat, and then there was this whole Rube Goldberg contraption to get data back down, but they elected not to use it because it was technically risky. Any other questions? Go ahead.
I have a quick question about the link budget. I don't want to piss off my neighbors, but I do have an attic. That rotor is really small, which is good news. And if it's a small enough Yagi, do you think that goes through roof material easily? I guess the low frequency is fine.
It's going to depend on your roof and whether it's raining or not. Are you cutting me off at some point? Okay, good. No, go ahead. You plug in. Yeah, it's going to depend on the satellite you're trying to receive. The APT stuff, if you're trying to receive the NOAA weather satellites, you can hear that basically underground. Other satellites, it's going to be application dependent. It's going to depend on your antenna, and it's going to depend on the roof and the frequency especially. The lower frequencies, you'll get through the roof pretty easily.
Yeah.
Anything above, anything above a few hundred megahertz is not going to go through that very well.
A few hundred, okay. It's like half inch plywood plus shingles.
Yeah. And when it rains, everything will go to crap.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Anything else? Cool. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nick. So next up, we've got Josh Meyer. He's going to talk about demodulating that telemetry from the rocket launch down at Vandenberg Air Force Base. Josh is a data scientist at BitTorrent, where he gets to measure the whole internet when he's not being a manager. He also designs electronic kits, is a dad to a four-year-old, and it's kind of a newbie to SDR, well, in his opinion. I reckon he's actually pretty decent, as you'll find out, and ready to design in general. And in parentheses it says, he wrote this, including his parenthetical.
Hello. I was hoping to get a jump on this by coming up early to get my monitor set up, but it's apparently not. There we go. Cool. Okay. Perfect. So, why are you confused? Okay, cool. So, hi, I'm Josh. I'm gonna have to ask everybody to hold questions and comments and stuff till I'm done. I am getting over a cold and I do not know how much of a voice I'm going to have to give my presentation. Also, I'm having a hard time hearing, so is the microphone okay? Like, okay, cool. Anyway, my talk is going to be slightly anticlimactic. I'm going to mention that up front. A while ago, I set out to decode some Atlas V rocket launch telemetry.
the trying to is really important. It did not go so well. However, you know, it's still a cool story. And actually, there's some interesting stuff in here that Balint was interested in me talking about, because I hate GRC. Actually, stepping back, how many people are new-ish to SDR here? Okay, good. I got a crowd. So GRC is the default thing. It's awful if you're a software person. You just gonna hate it. Once you get used to it, it's really great.
You're gonna hate it so much. Why don't you tell us a little bit about it first?
Okay, yeah. So GRC is a flow-based thing. I'll actually show it to you here in a second. But it's this thing. This is what your program looks like. This one is very well organized and clean. Thank you. Why did that? Oh boy. Yeah, sorry. Things are supposed to be mirrored. Oh my god. Sorry. This is my first time using this monitor for a presentation. How does anyone get anything done on Linux? Honest question. Like, I remember back when I was a Linux person. But now... the hell? Wow.
There we go.
Oh, no. I'm just trying very hard to get back to something useful. Okay. I don't know how to make these several warts go away off of my screen.
Close that display window.
I was trying to... Oh, you know what? Alt F4 probably still works. Wow, I opened a lot of those. Hooray! It turns out NoiseBridge is the right place to have questions about using Linux. Anyway, okay, so this is GRC. This is actually a nice, simple program. I use the rotate feature. Other people do not. So you get other programs that look more like...
like Balint's graphs.
Yeah, Balint. Balint's really good at GRC, this actually, like, there's sub-pieces of this that Balint helped me write. So this is kind of what they wind up looking like, but several screens of this. Personally, I have a very hard time reasoning about that and telling what has happened and what my diffs are and so on and so forth in this environment. It is really great for knocking out really quick stuff, though. So I'm not the biggest on GRC. I am a Python person, though, and I do use IPython all the time at work. So I figured out how to load the data into NumPy inside of IPython. Who's heard of IPython? Okay, cool. I'll talk about it more for the folks who haven't. And how to do your own work over inside of IPython using NumPy, etc. Just to set this up, some friends and I did some high-altitude ballooning stuff. One of them is left. I think Adam's the only one here. Hi, Adam. He doesn't probably want me to announce his... Yeah, anyway. The picture that Nick had of his balloon burst, I think we're probably both. We're like, aww. Yeah. We did a bunch of these launches with these folks here. This actually started out of NoiseBridge. So these people got me into actually using my radio license, and it kind of has snowballed from there. We've kept in touch. Also, since we started the project, these three have gone on to work on actual satellites, all at Planet Labs, actually. And then this is the four of us who went down to the Vandenberg launch. The first question that I realize people might have is, how do you find out about an upcoming satellite launch of, you know, say, a classified payload at a military base in Southern California? And it turns out that there's just a mailing list, and Andy, who was here earlier, is on that mailing list, and he got the email, said, oh, hey, you know what, we should go down to this next week if you guys can. I had jury duty, and I was like, I don't know if I can go or not, I don't know. And we got down close to the day, and I'm like, you know what? I'll just forget about jury duty and hope that I don't wind up with a bench warrant.
to actually see a launch, you go down to Lompoc, which is this crappy little town, sorry to anybody from Lompoc, down by Vandenberg. And you can stay there. There's this Comfort Inn, which is pretty decent. I'll cover that really quick in a sec. But, and then to view it, there's a public park. Do you remember the name of the park?
It's Vandenberg Village Park.
Okay, Vandenberg Village Park. It's Vandenberg Village, a little town thing. Anyway, I suspect that it's complicated. Anyway, so the Comfort Inn, whenever we got there, I looked around and I'm like, wow, there's a lot of white pickup trucks here. And I thought, oh, okay. And then I got to my room, and this is the card with the channel listing. They highlighted very helpfully the channels that you probably want to watch. My immediate conclusion is that people from San Francisco don't stay here much. They've highlighted HBO, ESPN, and ESPN2, and also Fox News, and that is it. So, anyway, so I took down a field kit. I took down a B210 in a case. I've heard that they're fragile outside of a case. 5-volt wall wart, US 3.0 capable laptop, this piece of junk, an Edis log periodic antenna, an inverter, a long extension cord, which I meant to take, but I forgot, and my super cool alt as mount. Actually, I'll go to the picture first. This is my alt as mount. This is two of Edis's, somebody's antennas that you can buy with your usurp. Just duct taped to a camera tripod that's half broken. And then down on the leg there, I've duct taped my B210 in its case so that it's all contained. And then the other thing that I was really careful about is that I zip-tied all the lines to the thing for strain relief, because that is actually the failure mode that I've heard happens in the field with B210s, where it's ballant. So we get out there, we get all set up. I'm sitting out the side of the car because I don't have a long enough power cord to actually go anywhere, and start collecting the data. I didn't really worry about the rest of this yet. I was just worried about finding the very basic details of what frequency I needed. So it's a question of where is it, what is it, and what do I need to capture? So I tried Googling to find this. Like, somebody has to have tried to do this before. So, like, where's telemetry? Okay, Google Atlas V telemetry. Google Atlas V RF. Tried a bunch of things. And at some point, I'm just like, bah, Atlas V manual. Turns out, there's a user's guide for this rocket. So, you just go and download this. And it's got so much stuff in it. It's a 420-page PDF. I printed out several bits of it from the hotel's business suites or whatever the hell they call that thing with the printer. That's what we use as our Bible what I use for my Bible, I guess, for capturing the data the next day. Turns out that there's actually three transponders on here. Well, actually, there's one transponder, one transmitter, and one FTS, flight termination system. They give specs for these things. The C-band, by the way, the band system, for those of you new to radio, was invented in World War II for the purpose of radar research. It was chosen so that it was hard to, like, remember and decode. Literally chosen to keep it secret. So if you get frustrated with the band names, it's working. So this thing is a transponder up at, 5.765 gigahertz, plus or minus 3 megahertz. Like, that's their center, is like, meh, in that region. It is megahertz here. I'm using gigahertz when I speak. Question was what units they were in. It's pulse modulated. It's got some other stuff on it. I looked at it and I'm like, I don't think that's probably what I want. Also, it's kind of towards the edge of what the usurp is rated for, and I'm not really confident with my antennas and stuff up there because I've never used it there. So on to the next one. S-band. This one's at 2211 megahertz, plus or minus 4 kilohertz. That sounds reasonable. The Doppler shift is going to be around that whenever the thing takes off. Bandwidth is plus or minus 4 megahertz, and I don't know what minus 4 megahertz means exactly. But, that's reasonable. That's in spec. Modulation is BPSK, QPSK, which, what? What do you mean by BPSK slash QPSK? So you read on. They tell you that its telemetry is NRZ-N, so non-return to zero mark, at 1024, 256 kilobits per second on the I channel with some standard forward error correction stuff. And then there's also a channel of data on the Q channel, which I didn't know you could do that before this. Since then, I have actually found out that this is a thing called UQPSK, if I remember correctly, unbalanced quadrature phase shift key modulation, commonly used in satellites and space stuff. So for those of us who have absolutely no background in this, it's slightly baffling. So it's supposed to be PSK. So I chose to go with this, but I did want to mention the FTS receiver. The spec on this one makes me very happy. Center frequency of 421 megahertz, stability plus or minus 0.005%. Like, no, this is where it's going to be. For some reason, they want to know exactly where that thing is. So I decided to go with the S-band stuff because it seemed reasonable. To capture, I did a really obvious GRC sketch of just a usurp source, a scope, and a file sync. And so that was actually kind of fun because I got the scope up and I can see the waveform of it whenever I pointed at the rocket. And so I'm sitting there with my, sitting out the edge of this car, trying to maneuver my crappy camera mount to keep the antenna pointed in the right direction, and watching this little signal bounce around, pretty small. And then like a couple minutes before launch, a minute before launch, suddenly my little tiny single, like, goes foomp, 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 when they turn the transmitter on for real. It's just like, it got at least, I don't know, like 9 dB louder or something like that. It was just a huge jump in amplitude. It was quite impressive. And that's another gotcha for newbies. If you want reasonable clock rates that aren't divisors of 32 megahertz, you've got to set the master clock signal rate. That doesn't mean anything to you now, but it might make sense to you later whenever you get goofy error messages about choosing 10.166666 megahertz. So I now have the data. I'm trying to figure out what it is. I'm going to give you one story here. The actual story is that Ballant, like 2 weeks later, so I went and did this. I'm like, I don't know how to analyze this. I should call Ballant or something, but I don't want to be like, hey, can you do me a favor and let's hang out and look at rocket telemetry? And then 2 weeks later, I'm hanging out at home on Saturday and I get a text message from Ballant being, hey, are you around this afternoon? I'm like, yes, actually. Cool, can I come park in your driveway? So he came up and, well, actually, I don't know. Did you ask to park in my driveway or did I say you could do that? Anyway, he parked in my driveway because I live here in the Mission. And he was up for some stuff. So he showed me Baudline. We did a bunch of stuff with Baudline that you can't download yet, I don't think. So I'm going to talk about a different way of doing it. So that is this piece right here. So this is GNU Radio running a thing. So is that still good for the audio? Ah, that was a mistake. Okay, I apologize that this is still kind of small. Also, changing the resolution has changed the calibration of my digitizer. So anyway, so this is just the raw data. Plotted the in-phase on X and the quadrature on Y. And if you look at that, like, can you kind of see that there's two little things spinning around each other there? That smells like BPSK, that it's not quite on frequency, and so it's spinning. So first thing I thought is, okay, well, let's go ahead and do this. Let's add a thing to actually translate the frequency down and see if we can't get that to go better. So here, you know, if we change the frequency, we see that it spins a fair bit there, gets a little bit less coherent there. Anyway, so it turns out that around 3.8, 4K is where the sweet spot for this, but it's still bouncing around too much. So we need a phase lock loop of some sort to keep the things in phase. Handily enough, there is a piece in GRC to do this. This is actually the power of GRC, by the way. It has all these things built in. It's just impossible to find them if you don't know what you're looking for. So I think that's sort of visible. So this is after adding the Costas loop, where suddenly we're actually getting a reasonable looking display. It's called a constellation display. So there's clearly two lobes, and they're on the x-axis, and they're kind of separated. It'd be nice if they were better separated. It turns out, by the way, that all of this work, I could have just short-circuited and used one component called the constellation plot, which gives a beautiful, beautiful constellation plot right out of the gate. Can everybody see that okay? Okay, cool. So it really does look like this is BPSK, or at least for the most part. So now there's a question of, what bit rate is that PSK happening at? So this is another thing that Ballant helped me out a bunch with. So what we're going to do here is use an FFT to try and figure out what frequency component is the strongest in there, because that's probably either our actual symbol rate or twice our symbol rate due to the way that PSK is going to work out on this. So if we go through and do this, we take in our actual capture, run it through throttle, run it through the Costas loop to stabilize it out, and then we do a bunch of goofy type juggling to get it into the FFT. And then I wanted the thing to actually tell me the answer. So down in the bottom corner here, I'm bringing in a thing where I cut off the bottom of the Fourier transform to get rid of the DC component, because otherwise it's going to be too big. So multiply those through, do this stuff. Then we get this plot sync over here so we can actually see what's happening. And over here, I've got a little number thing that's going to display that shows us the actual number of the bin that it's in, like the frequency. So we run this, and this is the actual data. And what we've got here is this maximum bucket is like 1.5 megahertz or so, which makes some sense. And this is the auto scale. Do the right thing. There we go. This is the Fourier transform of that. So it looks, you know, like there's something around there. It's not unreasonable. So that seems like a good candidate. It doesn't match anything on the data sheet, but we're going to run with it. So that's roughly what I expect, is a 1.5-ish megahertz signaling frequency for our actual binary data. So now I can get some idea of what the underlying modulation is, and now we go up a layer in the stack to what coding is it using. Ballant looked at it and was like, it's Manchester encoder. And I'm like, okay, I'll take your word on that. But I never take anybody's word on everything. So I actually spent some time loading the actual data in to IPython here. And then the blue line here is the actual PSK demodulated, the Costas loop output. The green lines are the demodulated binary data. And the blue lines down here are just the data. I went through and counted how long each of those edges are, because in Manchester encoding, you're going to have link 1 and link 2, and that's pretty much it. And it turns out that if you do a histogram of the links of those runs, you get something that fits about what I was expecting to see. So this is good. So Ballant was, in fact, right, which... He was clearly right because he showed me a picture of what it would look like if it got decoded. So now there's a question of, we use the Manchester decoding to get from the modulated signal to the bit stream. But there's a question then of what the bit stream is actually encoding. Like, is it ASCII text? Is it this? Is it pictures? What's in there? So first, in finding out what framing it's using, you kind of want to figure out the shape of the frames. Given that it's telemetry, we expect fixed length and so on and so forth. So it should be pretty repetitive inside of the stream. So the right way to do this is probably to use autocorrelation to figure out how often the signal looks like itself. Does that make sense to the radio people? Like, yeah, obviously. Everybody else can ignore that because we're about to show you how to do it in a more interesting way. I used to reverse engineer network protocols for a living, actually with Adam. Anyway, so one of the things I've learned over the years is that you can see patterns really, really fast. So I tend to try and get things into image form as soon as possible. So one way that we can get this data into image form is actually just make a... So this is different data, by the way. I've got a little simpler example to show some tricks. You can look at the plot to see if it looks like that. That's cool, but you can only fit so many data points in that way. So this has only got 1,000 data points, and it's kind of getting crowded in an IPython window. And this is a lot of telemetry, so it's probably wider. The way to see wider patterns is to rasterize it, so turn it all into pixels, and get a bunch of pixels that you can display. So this is actually some of the data from the rocket. After Manchester Decoding, put through a spectrum map, and it's clear that we have some bit alignment issues and so on and so forth, but... yeah, so I want to talk really quick about how to find these things and how to do it without going totally crazy. So I made a simpler example that I think is a bit more accessible. So I've got a file full of data. It's this thing called wap.txt. NumPy is really cool because you can just have it load a whole array of data from a file with one line, and you can tell it what the data type is. So here I'm just telling it, this is 256, this is 8-bit integers. Pull the data in, do a plot. Okay, that looks like data. And this is small enough, I can plot the whole thing and say, that looks like data with a pattern in it. And now we just go ahead and rasterize it, which, again, very easy to do in this framework. And if I treat it as, if I treat the first 2,500 entries as a 50 by 50 image, this is what I get as a color map output. And there's definitely a pattern in that, right? So there's definitely structure to this data. So then it's a question of how wide is it supposed to be, and is it a perfectly repeating pattern? So I look at the length of that thing and say, okay, so if it's a perfect square of data, just as a first shot in the dark, how big would it be? So it's going to be 188 pixels wide. So here I've done the same... image mapping trick, the same rasterization trick with 188 wide. So you can see an awful lot of the pattern all at the same time. This is clearly not right. So I'm just going to kind of guess a bit. Wrong key combo. So this is as a 280 wide image, and it's squished differently. So let's try, and it looks like it's slanting down into the left. So I'm going to go down a little bit. And wow, hey, that looks good. So again, it's going down into the left, right? So I'm going to go down a bit, like 230. And now it's down into the right and really tight. So I clearly overshot. So now, working my way back, again down into the right. So I need to go up again. We know 250 was the other direction, so 245 is close. 246 is it. And to make it a little bit easier to read, we'll do... So yeah, this was going to actually be my title slide. If everybody knows the I don't know what I'm doing cat. So that's kind of the process of figuring out rasterization. And trying to find your frame width in that. There's another example down here that's a little bit simpler, but I think that last one was good enough. I don't want to repeat the point, especially because it's like 9:45. What I wound up doing is running that same sort of a process on the Manchester bitstream from the Vandenberg launch. So here's like the first thing that I got out of it, and there's clearly structure in it, so we're on the right track. And I made it a little bit wider just to see what it looks like, and we've got some structure again. And then let's just make it really freaking wide. So pulled it on out to be 2,560 bytes wide, which is actually 8 times that in terms of bits. So this is two and a quarter K? Anyway, it's a very wide telemetry frame, and it looks like it's actually right, because we've got a lot of vertical lines in there. And if you look, there are big ugly patches, like this one right here, and it only occurs once per line, or once per chunk, so we're probably in the right place. And what I did is I took the literally 40 gigabytes of RF that I captured that day and turned them into a set of ping images. Sorry, that was the wrong one. And of course, yeah, this is what I get for not opening the right tab ahead of time. Also, you can see I use a very rigorous naming scheme for all of my work in progress stuff. Anyway, so this is what the telemetry looks like for the first, I forget what it is. This is for several minutes, I think, of data. You've got this big, wide section of really interesting stuff followed by a bunch of segments of really boring stuff with a bit of interesting stuff. A little bit more actual entropy here, and then boring, and so on and so forth. And then if we go down to this other section, where we go from red to green, in the color scheme that I'm using, that means that the data has moved pretty far from in terms of value, which suggests to me that the Manchester bitstream is no longer bit aligned the same way it was. So, you know, there's segments of noise in here, like this one right here, where we can see that actually this decode looks like it's doing its job, because we get structure a bunch of the time, and then occasionally when I have a hard time moving my tripod at the right way, or I bump it or whatever, you get noise. So we get this noise, and then suddenly the position of the telemetry in the stream jumps. And unfortunately, this is kind of where my talk ends, because I haven't actually managed to decode it any further than this. But I thought it was a pretty cool project thus far. I'm not sure how much of this I can actually decode anyway. While preparing this presentation, I actually have learned a bit about this kind of telemetry. Turns out that 2211 is a thing called the TDRSS system from NASA. TDRS. Thank you. TDRS. I learned another thing this evening. So yeah, TDRS, which is a system they use to get data to McMurdo Station and also to track launches and do lots of other things. The manual for it is NASA... is the TDRS System Network User Guide or something like that? Anyway...
Yes.
Yeah, so it acronyms out to the NASA SNUG. I liked reading the SNUG PDF to try and figure out what the hell is going on here. And it turns out there's a lot of options for the encodings there, and a lot of them were things like the unbalanced quadrature phase shift key stuff. So there might actually be two bit streams of data in here that are getting all mangled together that I need to actually figure out how to tease apart and so on and so forth. So that's where this project ends, but I did want to take advantage of this opportunity because I figured a lot of people here would be new to SDR to talk about SDR, and in particular SDR for S people. I'm very much a software person who's gotten into this, and there's two points of encouragement that don't sound like encouragement just yet, which is DSP isn't voodoo. It's just calculus on the complex plane with a bit of computer science that you have to worry about. And the other component of all of this, radio, isn't voodoo. It's just calculus on the complex plane with some physics thrown in. And whenever you're doing this stuff, statistics for good measure. That should not bother you. That should not keep you from doing anything. They're just really good excuses to tell yourself whenever you have done something really dumb and need to encourage yourself to keep going. In terms of starting, though, there's such a steep learning curve. There are a whole bunch of books that I have bought and tried. The two that I really liked are Digital Filters by Hamming. This is a classic. It's, I think, the first book on digital filtering technology. And I'm pretty sure it's the first one because this is what Hamming did at Bell Labs when he convinced people that digital filtering was something worth trying to do. I really liked it. It's a Dover. It's $12. The math in it is a little bit steep, but I think that's unavoidable, unfortunately. So bone up on your calculus a little bit ahead of time. And then the other one that I really like is Telecommunications Breakdown. This is a textbook. I have no idea who it's aimed at. It feels kind of like it's community college, except that it's all calculus. So maybe it's like mid-undergrad or something. I suspect that, though, is why it's no longer in print. It's usually pretty easy to obtain on Amazon and other places, both new, old stock, and used. It's like $30 to $60, but it's totally, totally worth that. And then the other thing I would mention, too, when talking about books, is that the difference between a really expensive book and a not-so-good book, for some other stuff I wanted to play with, I was looking at Radar, and the difference between the $120 Radar book and the $30 Radar book is immense, because I could actually follow the $120 one. It's expensive because people are using it, and it's the most common textbook, and so on and so forth. And the other one is written by this guy who clearly knows what he's doing, but clearly has no idea how to explain things. So consider it an investment and in your time. But these two books are both incredibly good value for money. If you're interested in like getting more info on them or something, you can take a camera phone picture of this and find them later on. But yeah, they're fantastic. So that is it. Yeah. Should I do questions or should I just move
okay,
on?
Okay, two questions.
Questions? No questions?
Oh,
yes.
Where did you get the case for your
B210? Where did I get the case for my B210? I know, it'd be great if somebody sold cases for the B210, wouldn't it? I would be so happy to be able to buy one of those. I would give them money.
All right, thanks, John.
So, seriously though, it's just a standard extrusion case.
Okay.
It's, yeah, I can get the exact model number for you. Oh, shoot, I got tangled up. So yeah, so that's that. Any other questions? Yeah.
To what extent do you think you were limited by relatively poor signal quality, and would you go back again with better antenna?
So the question was, do I think I was limited by poor signal quality? And would I go back with a better antenna? And actually, I got amazing signal the whole time I was there. So all of the limitations are just my own ignorance and slapdash. Like, I mean, you saw my alt-az mount, so yeah. Anyway, thank you so much.
Thanks, Josh.
I have a question for you, just as Jonathan gets set up. Do you think you'll analyze that signal a little bit more and try and pull it apart?
So yeah, I have thought about that a bit. I suspect this is going to be another one of my little white whale projects where I can't give up something that I know I'm not going to succeed at. So yeah. Anyway. Okay.
All right. Now we'll finish up with Jonathan Penlam. He's going to talk about making FPGA acceleration and SDRs more accessible. Jonathan is an R&D engineer at Edis Research. He graduated last spring from Northeastern University with a master's degree in computer engineering. He first got involved in SDR during his undergraduate studies at Purdue University, where he joined a communications research group trying to make a Galileo receiver with the USERT 1. So, take it away, Jonathan.
Hello, everybody. Let's see if I can get this. All right, everybody. So my name is Jonathan Penlam, and this is a presentation on RF Network on Chip. This is a quick introduction. I know it's getting late, so I'll try to get through this stuff early. I'm an R&D engineer at Edis Research. I graduated from Northeastern University, master's degree in computer engineering, just this spring. I've been active in SDR since about 2007, where I started at Purdue University in the SDR research group. Also, last summer, I had the privilege to be a part of Google Summer of Code 2013. For those of you not familiar, Google Summer of Code, Google actually funds students to work on open source projects, open And I work particularly on GNU Radio, porting GNU Radio to the Zinc, as well as doing FPGA acceleration. If you want more information about the Zinc, I won't get into it too much here. There's actually a link up here, and when we post my slides, you can go there as well. So to begin with, how many people have heard of FPGAs at all? Wow, excellent. So this is good. A lot of people have heard of them. So for those that you have not, FPGA stands for Field Programmable Gate Array. And so the idea behind FPGAs is you have this IC that has a sea of logic blocks with programmable interconnect. These logic blocks are generally composed of lookup tables so you can implement Boolean logic, along with registers and block RAMs for storage elements, and then fixed functional elements like multipliers. And what you can do is you can take these various components together and make higher level functions. For instance, in an FPGA, you could implement, say, DSP functions like filters, and you could also do things like implement state machines or interface with other devices. In fact, FPGAs are somewhat general in that respect, that they could actually implement other processors. They call these soft processors. There's 32-bit RISC architectures out there available for FPGAs to run. But, of course, FPGAs also suffer from this fact that they are a jack-of-all-trades but master of none. So while they are very generic and you can create these other functions with them, they do run slower than, say, something like a hard processor that's just made from an ASIC. So why are FPGAs at all useful, though? Why do we care about them? One of the big things is this idea of extreme parallelism. So I said that you had all these logic blocks that are connected to each other with a programmable interconnect. So the idea is that you could have multiple, essentially, circuits running in parallel, and you can exploit this parallelism. There's a lot of algorithms out there that, for instance, filters and FFTs and things like that, that can run a lot of it in parallel, and FPGAs can really accelerate those applications. FPGAs today actually have thousands of multipliers in there, so you can exploit these algorithms where if you can do 1,000 multiplies in parallel, an FPGA is a great platform for that. As well, they're highly, highly deterministic, and this is huge in certain areas. And in fact, in some areas in SDR, certain protocol processing, where when a certain condition happens, you want to know at some number of nanoseconds later, some number of clock cycles later, that you have the answer or you're going to react to it. An FPGA can give you that determinism. Processors, unfortunately, in general, cannot. First of all, because they're pipelined and they could have interrupts and cache misses, but also on processors you have operating systems, and if it's not real-time, you could have context switching. So that's one big benefit of FPGAs is that they're just very highly deterministic, which is quite a bit more difficult to get in a processor. Another aspect is this flexible I.O., where you can hook up a lot of different devices. FPGAs sometimes are like the glue for an entire system, where you're hooking up analog to digital converters, digital-analog converters, various memories, all sorts of other devices. In fact, they'll hook up with other processors and be able to shuttle that data into the processor, maybe over a high-speed serial link. The reprogrammable, this is a huge part of FPGAs. It's the fact that you can have an FPGA doing some fixed function right now, say filtering, but then you decide, okay, now we're going to switch this out and try to maybe implement a processor. And you can do that. It can be reprogrammed. It'll be a completely different function. And they also have programming language support, which is kind of a funny thing when I bring this up, but when FPGAs were first introduced, they were a bit harder to program, but today we have, you know, we have Verilog, System Verilog, VHDL, so these are more low-level, easier to, or more somewhat difficult to use languages, but typically that's what most people use. And there's a lot of these higher-level languages coming out that makes it very, very easy to get into FPGAs. Of course, there are drawbacks, because the higher you go, the more inefficient the implementations can be, so it's a bit of a trade-off there. So what are FPGAs and SDR? What do we do with FPGAs and SDR? Well, one thing I brought up was their parallelism. And a lot of SDR algorithms have a lot of parallelism. One of the very often used algorithms would be a fast Fourier transform, which is the more parallel version of the discrete Fourier transform. You take this discrete Fourier transform with the summation. You have to do a lot of additions and multiplies. And through some mathematical trickery, you can set it up where you do several stages, and you can do these stages with parallel multiply accumulates in them. And so in this case, they're showing the butterfly diagram for an FFT. It's quite a beautiful structure here, and it's for the 8-point FFT. And you can see in here, if I can get my mouse here, we have three distinct stages or three distinct sets of butterflies here. And each one of these have multiply accumulates here at the edge. Now, one nice thing about the 8-point FFT is it turns out that these multiplies are cheap. They're just plus or minus one. Real FFTs that are bigger are not that cheap, unfortunately. Now, in a serial processing or a regular processor implementation, we've really dumbed this down, not say a modern multi-core SIMD processor, but just something real simple that can just do one multiply after another. You're going to have to go through all these multiply accumulates one after another, and then you're going to have to go back up here and go to the next stage and do them all. And that can be quite cumbersome if you're doing a very large FFT, and you need to do it quickly in real time. And in FPGA, you have the parallel processing, and you have all these multipliers in there. So you could do all these multiplies right in parallel from stage to stage. And in fact, if you really want to dedicate the resources, you can actually do all these multiplies essentially stage by stage at the same time. Now, there's this concept of pipelining in here where you would actually have some storage elements in between the stages, and you would load them up one, and you'd have some latency getting through this FFT, but they'd all kind of happen in parallel, and it would happen very, very quickly. So I hope I kind of convinced you somewhat that FPGAs are quite useful for certain applications, especially in a lot of algorithms. And today, with Edis Research's third generation devices, we have really large FPGAs on them because they've really benefited from Moore's Law. And I've been doing FPGA work for about 8 years now, and it's amazing to see generation to generation how these devices double in size and the cost seems to go in half, especially recently. The latest generation jump has just been it's just blown up. And it's really amazing. And so on these devices, we have this Xilinx Kintex 7 device that's really big. It's got tons of memory. I know about 3 to 4 megabytes doesn't sound that big, but it really, for these devices, that's a lot of memory, and you can do a lot with it. And it's extremely fast as well. And you have 1,540 multipliers. So you can definitely do a lot of multiplication in parallel. And after we implement some of Edis's fixed logic in there that we have in all of our devices, you end up with 85% free space. So you got this FPGA, you got a lot of free space, you can maybe do some really cool stuff on it, but how do you exploit that? I mean, one of the things, you also have 200 megahertz of instantaneous bandwidth coming from this. You know, full 200 megahertz, this is complex samples coming into your software-defined radio. Most modern processors can't keep up with it. It really makes sense to exploit the FPGA. And our goal here would be, well, why don't we use, you know, existing sort of frameworks and software, but enable FPGA's acceleration within them? You know, we want to be able to exploit this heterogeneous processing on the FPGA and processing on, say, your host computer. And you want it to be composable, modular. I want to be able to take blocks and put them where they make sense, maybe on the FPGA or maybe on the host processor, depending on the algorithm.
There's a button in your flow graph.
Wow, look at it go. That's an ugly looking thing, too. I'm lost or something. So you also want to be able to reuse and rearrange your blocks. And you know, here in this simple flow graph, maybe I want to take my filter and throw it on the FPGA. But right now it just isn't as easy as that. I just can't move it over there with a click of a button traditionally. Well, at Edis Research, we're trying to really address this problem. And what we've come up with is RF network on chip. So this is what will be inside the FPGA, is this network here where we have this radio transport router, which is the heart of it, which will allow us to implement a packetized network where we can send sample data from, say, fixed units like our radio cores to either back to the host through these other fixed units that are our ingress and egress PCIe Ethernet ports, or we can send them to down here to computation engines. And then you can, in the computation engines, this is where you can implement your DSP algorithms. And other, even things beyond that, you know, state machines, other control aspects. So what does RFNOC really do for us? Well, the idea is it's really making FPGA acceleration more accessible. You're given dedicated FPGA space for these computation engines. And, you know, some examples, FIR filter, FFT, of course, but, you know, LFDM sync, there's one that we have working that we're going to try to release soon. Costas loop, bit synchronizer, cryptography. And this is actually an interesting point. I'm going to go a little bit on a side trail here. As Josh had brought up the fact that he's doing the unbalanced QPSK, I actually worked with the TETRAS system and a TETRAS transponder that's hopefully being launched next year on a satellite. We'll see if they keep delaying it. It turns out that transponder has an FPGA in it, and you use unbalanced QPSK because you can actually, within the transponder in this FPGA, you can treat it as BPSK, which when you use a Costas loop to demodulate it, BPSK is more resource efficient than QPSK, especially on these radiation-hardened devices that go up in those satellites. So I thought that just was an interesting tidbit that Josh brought that up, and it really rang a lot of bells. So anyways, back to this presentation. Also in these dedicated space for computation engines, you can do low latency protocol processing. And this is that other highly deterministic low latency area that's important is say if you're working with Wi-Fi. Wi-Fi uses something called a CSMA, carrier sense multiple access. The idea is I'm going to listen and hear if anybody else is transmitting. And if they are, I need to back off and wait for a certain amount of time. And then I'll see if they're there again, if they're still there. And if they're not, okay, then I'll go ahead and transmit. Well, the thing is if you're running your receiver on your host computer, you have Ethernet latency. You know, it could be tens, hundreds of microseconds, maybe milliseconds, who knows. And those slot times are very small. They're just microseconds wide. And so, it depends, tens of microseconds. And so what could happen is by the time you detect that the spectrum is completely ready for you to go ahead and transmit, well, shoot, somebody else with a faster computer or an actual dedicated ASIC to do this, they beat you to it, and you actually end up stomping on them because you transmitted when you thought nobody was transmitting, when in reality somebody was. So that's another great thing about this, doing things in FPGA, and especially with an RFNOC, is you can do these things very low latency, you know, have turnaround times in the hundreds of nanoseconds to maybe microseconds. And the important thing with RFNOC is that it's handling a lot of this infrastructure work that is really, a lot of times you need FPGA domain experts to deal with. That's really just getting data from and into your FPGA and this packetization and the routing and everything. It's handling that for you. And as well, these concepts are like flow control, so you don't overflow and underflow various computations as you're sending and receiving data from them. And really another neat thing, too, is, you know, we do software-defined radio software, you think, oh, you need a host. Well, the nice thing about RFNOC is on your devices, you could maybe not have a host. It could self-program and just be an autonomous device that's running just by itself. And this can be a really powerful thing to exploit. Another really important thing is that these computation engines that are going to be your playground of implementing your algorithms, they have very simple interfaces. Again, you know, RFNOC is handling all this higher level, more complicated infrastructure. You're basically given a very simple data valid sort of interface that's really easy to work with. And there's a lot of existing IP out there that this particular interface called AxiStream is an industry standard. So you can go get IP that's off of, say, opencores.org that has a lot of cores out there that are available for free open source that you can just drop right in and exploit. There's things like Viterbi decoders. There's full-up processors, like I said. You know, RISC processors. Crypto stuff is on there. And you can just, you know, depending on if it's got that right AxiStream interface, which some of them do, you can just drop it right in and it generally would work. As well as each computation engine, this is an FPGA-specific thing. It's in Zen clock domain. This is really useful because when you're trying to run a lot of things in parallel, sometimes it's nice if you can run one part of it much faster than the other parts. For instance, the FFT. Once you have the data buffered up, it'd be nice if you could run it really fast so you could get your answer very quickly while the remaining data is buffering up, or the next FFT's worth of data is buffering up. And as well, we're handling a lot of the software API to just set everything up and get data in and out. So a lot of the details that can be very cumbersome to deal with are handled for you. And another really big and important thing is that it's supported in GNU Radio. You know, as we've seen, we have these flow graphs up there, and it's what you really want at the end of the day is have a library of FPGA blocks you can just drop and say, oh, I can, you know, I want to accelerate my FFT. Well, here's my FPGA RFNOC FFT. Drop it in, and it goes. And you don't have to be the domain expert for all these algorithms. So first I want to start off kind of showing a traditional flow graph, and this is within the EDIS research sort of device flow. So you have things up here like UHD, that's our library for talking to our devices. Down here, the USERP, this would be what is inside the FPGA more traditionally. And in fact, I put this radio transport router in there, but even in older devices, that's not even there. It's just simple logic that pretty much just connects this sort of Ethernet or maybe PCIe interface directly to your radios. So the traditional flow here would be, say I'm going to receive. Well, radio would just go out through Ethernet, come up, you know, through your operating system, through HD, and eventually in your flow graph come here out of your excuse me, USERP source, and then it would go through your flow graph. But in the RFNOC flow graph, now you have this radio transport router, and you have computation engines. So you can have an FFT computation engine in your FPGA. And you can see up here that some of these blocks have changed. One that's really important here to look at is now this RFNOC FFT. So instead, what we're doing is we're going from the radio, and we're sending our sample data over to our FFT. It's doing this computation. This Xilinx FFT IP core in Magenta, this is off the shelf with the Xilinx. Xilinx is the maker of the FPGAs that we use. Off the shelf, you can just drop it right in, and then bam, you have FFT acceleration right there. And there's no reason that you have to go through just one block. You can stream multiple blocks. So say you want to do a window before your FFT. Well, there you go. You just drop these blocks down in here, and now it's going to automatically configure the FPGA and everything, so the radio goes to the window for the FFT, and then back into your software at the right point. So to really show this off, I'm going to show a demo. Okay.
Looking good.
All right, so let's see which one we on here. Okay, so we're on the first one, which is the FFT. Hopefully you can see this okay. So what we have here is we have, since I don't have this hooked up just to send spectrum, I'm actually sending in signals that I'm creating. This is a really great debug tool too, right? Is that you don't want to just deal with signals that are coming out of the air right at the beginning.
Push the middle button.
Sure, what this does. What's that? What's laser. This doing? What?
Laser pointer.
Oh, thanks. Okay. Wow. So over here on the left here is that this is a really nice way to just get data into your system. You're generating a signal source, a noise source, adding them together. And then this is just some... it turns out that because we don't have a radio in here, what's the idea of a sample rate, right, if you're just doing processing? So we put a throttle in here to try to just create like an artificial sample rate of 10 megahertz. Stream to vector, just converting the arrange, how your data is arranged. And then it goes down here, which is into RF NOC, into the FPGA that's running on the X300 over here. First we go into a FIFO, and then this you think is an ingress. Then we go to the FFT and out, and you'll notice that these have special ports on here. And this out F goes to NF. These are connections that you can think of within the FPGA. It's routing data from this FIFO to the FFT. Another question you might ask is, why do I need a FIFO? Well, in GNU Radio, all these blocks run in their own thread. And so it turns out that it's more performant if you have a dedicated thread for handling ingress and a dedicated thread for handling egress. And then back up here, we just do complex to real. 20 log 10 standard, and then we're going to plot it with a vector sync. One interesting thing in this FFT block is I can specify the size as well as the output. It could be magnitude squared, maybe just straight complex real imaginary data. And so these are configurable. And so that means the blocks inside the FPGA, those options are there where, especially like say magnitude, you're not doing that calculation on the host anymore, you're doing it in the FPGA. So let me go ahead and run this for us. And did I plug everything in? Try to do everything quickly, which, let's see if I can. Is that guy plugged in, ready to go?
I can cycle it if you like. PPS is blinking.
Yeah, let me do
I got link activity.
Let me ping it real fast. Just make sure I'm talking to it. No, I am not.
Do you want me to cycle?
No, I think it's because I had to unplug and go over here, so I try cycling now.
Cycle?
Yeah. So while we're waiting here to go ahead and let this cycle, I can...
Okay, it's up.
All right, let's see if I can ping it real fast. Oh, there it goes. All right, we're back alive. Excellent. Okay. There we go. So now I can see we're rolling here. There's a lot of more... Oh, man, it went over here. Great. So let me move... Let me move that over there. And we'll do full screen. So now you can see this is the FFT running with my data that I'm producing locally. It's not over the air. Everything's aligned nice and properly. I go right, increase frequency. You can see the single tone goes left and right. This is actually kind of a funny thing because I had to add a custom block besides the Xilinx block to do that, because if any of you used MATLAB or other you know, FFT calculations, generally your output comes in natural order, where the left and right sides of your frequency here are actually flipped. So your center frequency is very all the way off the left. And so when I first did this, well, it was backwards. So you would move the slider right, but your signal wouldn't go where you would expect it to. So there's a little block in there to handle that for us automatically. The noise amplitude over here, I can decrease. One interesting thing is as I get this really small, you start seeing these dropouts. This is an important aspect of FPGAs, is if you're just used to doing things in software completely, you'll usually use doubles and floats, and you have tons of dynamic range, tons of precision. An FPGA, using floating point and processing, can sometimes be quite wasteful. It uses a lot more resources than are really necessary. So in this case, inside the device, we're doing complex shorts. And we have only so much dynamic range. And when I decrease the noise floor so far, eventually my FFT starts outputting zeros. Well, 10 to the power of what gives us a zero? Negative infinity. So I have these really deep nulls here that are just due to my lack of precision. But it kind of looks funny when you see it. Another really interesting thing about this too, and when I first built this I noticed, is boy, this guy looks really sharp. This is surprisingly sharp actually for an FFT. If you're receiving things over the air, you'd actually expect some lobes on it unless you're doing windowing. This is like super sharp. Well, it turns out that I set my wave frequency to be a multiple of my FFT size. And so that is basically setting my tone right in the middle of my bends perfectly. And that only will generally happen if you're generating that data locally or using some sort of frequency compensation loop. But generally, that won't happen. So let me put in just an off random number here. And oh, okay, there you go. Now it looks more natural. You have this sort of sloped effect to this. What's really happening is you have a sine wave coming in, and the ends are not perfectly matching between FFT or in the FFT. And so what happens is this is a discontinuity, and you get this sort of sine x over x. If we could zoom in, you would see it more clearly. But since we're far out, it kind of looks like a slope. This is a very typical thing in FFTs, and that's why windowing actually is used to make it much sharper. So this is the FFT flow graph. Let me go ahead and go to the window one now and kind of show that concept. So we have a window block in here that I've added. And what's interesting is I have this coefficients here. So since it's an FPGA, you can actually load you can actually change the window coefficients while it's running. So in this case, let me copy this real fast. Let's get it to something a little better. Okay. Okay, so we see what I was talking about before. We have this sort of sloped effect around the carrier, this sine x over x sort of look. And now that's because I'm using a boxcar, a rectangular window. I'm not doing anything special. We still have that discontinuity at the ends of our samples, or this section of samples. Now, if I were to paste in my coefficients and apply a Blackman window, bam, looks much nicer. And this is all happening in real time. I loaded new coefficients into the FPGA. That simple. That's really, especially if you have FPGA experience, that's really nice and easy. And then, you know, this looks nice and sharp, but the main lobe's a little wider. You know, that's an effect of using a window. So yeah, this is really great. You know, this is very powerful. When this guy running, you know, it's really cool because now at this point, you know, I'm doing simple stuff, FFTs. But you know, imagine you're doing this Costas loops as a loop bandwidth, and you can change that, you know, on the fly and see how that affects things. And you're doing it in the FPGA, something that can traditionally be quite difficult. So another one I want to show off is the FIR filter. And the same sort of thing applies here, where you can change out the filter coefficients. Let me get this over there. Okay, so we're running this live. I have that same tone with the noise. I actually am doing a very large FFT locally on the machine, so that's why it looks real nice here. But you might, I don't know if any, does anybody notice something funny about this FFT, this FIR filter, this output? There's something very funny about it. I actually got an email on this that I should have noticed, because in the past I've fixed this before. You may not notice, but if you look over here at the power level, it's at like minus 100. That's kind of funny. You know, if I'm applying an FIR filter, the pass band should ideally be at 0 dB, and then I'll have attenuation, and it'll be, the stop band will be at some lower dB level. So why is that? Well, again, this fixed point situation is the FIR filter inside it actually has bit growth. You may have samples coming in at 16 bits, but to keep precision internally, it increases that bit growth. It grows and increases the bit width over time, or over the multiplies internally. And so what happens is the output might be 40, 50 bits wide, but you don't want to pass around 40 or 50 bits in your FPGA. That's wasteful. So you go back down to 16. What's a very typical way of doing it? Well, I'll just take the upper 16 bits. Well, what if your signal didn't grow that large? Well, that will look like you basically maybe divided your signal by 2 to the 16th, and now you have tons of attenuation on it. If you're clever, you can get around that and still make it come out flat. But I just grabbed this FIR core and dropped it in there, and I was not clever, and so it came out like this. And actually, in my Google Summer of Code, if you go to my website, you'll see the FFT in there. Actually, the FIR filter in there.